Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome back to the second session of the day. I hope you had a good lunch. And I'm pleased to introduce a very distinguished gentleman and a champion of the environment and sustainability. He comes all the way from Indonesia, and he has spent some time today to spend a few minutes with us and to talk about the sustainable development goals that Indonesia is trying to achieve. So I would like you all to join me in welcoming General Panda Jaitan, the Coordinating Minister for Maritime Affairs, Government of Indonesia, to the stage. Please join me in welcoming him.
Yep. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I don't know how to thank you. I'm here today in such a very beautiful building in the Columbia University. My name is Luhut Panjaitan. I'm the Coordinating Minister for Maritime Affairs. My background, Army General retired. Yeah, so I'm doing now about many things related to the energy, clean energy, about tourism, and ocean, and many things. Thank you very much also to all of you that you are able to be here this afternoon. If you look at Indonesia, not many people understand that Indonesia, I think, is the largest archipelagic country on Earth. Consists of 17,000 islands, something. People ask me, you know, the exact number of Indonesian islands. I said like 17,500 something, you know. If you don't trust me, count by yourself, you know. Depend on the high tide and low tide. If you look at also next slide, this is the thing, the profile of our economy right now. For the last 10 years, Indonesia average growth is 5.7%. We are a member of G20. We are the fourth largest economy in 2040-2045 in terms of GDP. Largest market in Southeast Asia with promising digital industry growth. Also the fourth largest population. Right now our population 270 million. And 230 million Muslim population. So we are the largest Muslim population on Earth. Vibrant democracy. If you look at last April this year, our presidential election in one day, 8 hours, 870,000 polling stations, and 156 million people of Indonesia went to the polling station, no single one incident during the time. I don't believe America is the largest democrat country on Earth, you know, because if you look at in America, I don't know how many million going to the polling station in one day. But Indonesia, you see the size of Indonesia, and you look at also the, you know, the number of population, we are still able to manage Indonesia and very safe and very stable. If you look at also, ladies and gentlemen, Indonesia experienced negative export growth, but we are able also to, you know, to manage this country, although also the commodity price down, which is, I think, a bad experience for us. We like also to see in the near future, we not rely on the commodity price only. Among emerging market countries, I think Indonesia successfully maintained its growth. If you look at this slide, we make some comparison. Indonesia and Vietnam, Malaysia, Thailand, it's ASEAN country, and Turkey. Indonesia still in a very good condition. Although the trade war right now, whether you like it or not, make uncertainty globally in terms of economy and in terms of everything. Now, compared to regional currencies, Indonesian rupiah has one of the best performance, if you look at the slide. Thailand, Indonesia, and Philippines. And the rest, I think you look at now, negative. So this is also, you see, how do we manage our fiscal and monetary, I think very, very well. Because this is also the leadership of President Joko Widodo. Give a good example to the people over there. Less and less corruption in Indonesia. I'm not saying that we don't have a corruption. Still some corruption over there. But then when the president culturally give the good example, no business at all, the family also, no. Everybody also follow the, you know, the spirit of that. Now, if you look at also the economic growth, can be seen in the decreased poverty and Gini ratio. I think this first time in our history that our Gini ratio, our poverty below 10%. Even this year, I believe this is going to be below 9.7%. Maybe you can go down to 9.5%. In the same time, Gini ratio also improved from 0.4 something percent then to 0.0384. Maritime economic potential, like I mentioned earlier, we are the largest archipelagic country on Earth. Maybe you cannot imagine from eastern part of Indonesia to western part of Indonesia, Merauke to Sabang, it is like 7 hours 30 minutes with jet, and we have three time zone. So maritime economy potential in Indonesia, this is the size of that is huge, $1.3 trillion a year. But about only 11% been explored by us. So then the room to move is huge. Now if you look at also fisheries, in this, one of the highest GDP contributor, it's like this. So look at now the fisheries, national and forestry, you see the slide. Time to time, we are able also to maintain this moving up. Tourism is one of our economic condition. Java, Bali, Lombok, and the best island 2018. Maybe you're not aware about that. Even myself, I don't know where that Java is the best island by 2018. Compared to this, you see the slide. Bali is number two, Java number one. Waikiki number five, etc. So, out of seven, three in Indonesia. So Indonesia very, very rich and very, very beautiful. If we manage this very well, you can see Indonesia near future much different than today. Tourism sector has a significantly contribution foreign exchange revenue surplus. If you look at this slide, so now we boost very much a new Bali. This is Lake Toba, Borobudur, Mandalika, Labuan Bajo, and North Sulawesi. Bali is still the main tourist destination in Indonesia, but followed by Jogja and Mataram, Manado. It's grow very fast today. So if you can see the, you know, Indonesia, I'll compare it to maybe 5 years ago, it's a much, much different than today. Target 5 branding destination and 4 priority destination like this, Bali, Borobudur, like I mentioned earlier. So there are so many beautiful areas over there, you know. We just want to see, to prepare, detail, spot any tourist spot that they have to go. Now we are preparing this and we are moving very quick right now. And of course, we open to any investor to invest in this area. I give you a sample like Banyuwangi. This is also the one issue. It's very beautiful for you know, for what do you call it, surfing. We have 7 surfing destination world class in Indonesia. This one of the best. This is in G Island. We call it the G Island Golf. G Island in near Bali. In this is on the Banyuwangi Beach. On this, you look at that, that map over there. This is, I think, one example that I give it. When we fix the infrastructure over there, immediately number of tourism increase. Ladies and gentlemen, let me move now to Indonesia's commitment on to reduction by 2030. Yeah. Mitigation, adaptation. This is, I think, the program that make it by Indonesian government. So we are working very hard for this. Voluntarily pledged to reduce emission by 29% on national effort and up to 41% with international support. So international support for Indonesia is very important in order to speed up this target. Goal to reduce greenhouse gases through low carbon economy adaption to the negative impacts of climate change. Like I mentioned, early 29%, if there are international support, then we can go up to even much better. Now, ladies and gentlemen, if you look at also the most of the emission in 2017, 49% are composed of energy. Meanwhile, if you look at the slide, we can see the greenhouse gas emission in 2017 are lower than years before. So we're trying very hard. On the slide, you see that number. So we work very hard. How do we do it? I think a lot of things that been done right now in Indonesia, although we still not enough, we have to move more, we have to make it more and more. Like transportation and energy, LRT Greater Jakarta is from electric-based mass transportation beside MRT. Let me also brief you now. We have a program, Electric Car Indonesia. This already launched by the government. And you will see by 2020, we begin with this, but the peak of this, I believe, 2022 or 21 or 22. Why? Because since last year, since 3 years ago, nickel ore, we don't export, and we'll reduce the export of nickel ore. We see the added value of this. So we produce stainless steel, carbon steel, and also we extract cobalt from low-grade nickel ore. So meaning what? 70% of lithium battery material we can produce in Indonesia. Then finally, we decided to produce lithium battery within the country. So we're going to be the global player on lithium battery. So carbon, I think very important to reduce emission, because in Jakarta right now, pollution is considered very bad. Like a slide you see here, electric vehicle related industry. So large scale production of battery storage for electric vehicles will be groundbreaking already early this year. When we see the production end of next year or maybe beginning of 2021. Biodiesel, ladies and gentlemen, we promote the use of biodiesel to reduce the use of fossil fuel. We like to reduce fossil fuel because we have potential so much on geothermal. We have 29,000 megawatt of geothermal. If you include with the spring water, we can go up maybe to 90,000 megawatt. Biodiesel is very important for us because we don't want to see more using fossil energy. So this is also could reduce, I think, within 3 years' time in Jakarta. You're not going to see the bad emission in Jakarta anymore because of this program. Roadmap for the biodiesel implementation in Indonesia, I think very clear here, and we have worked very hard for this. So we don't want just talking, and seminar. I think it's enough. Now we are see how do we do. And then we fix any problem if we are facing that one. That's why research is very important on this. So been also promoting very much research on this issue. To the next slide, ladies and gentlemen, coral reef transplantation. This is, I think, one example that how serious we tackle this issue. This is, I think, last year with Madame Lagarde during the annual meeting IMF World Bank in Bali. You see right now, before and after. This picture, I think, after 8 months something. So today, maybe better than 4 months ago. So we have to maintain the coral reef in Indonesia, because we have the largest peatland, mangrove, coral reef, seagrass, many things. This is very rich country. People thought Indonesia just small country, you know, but no, we are very powerful and very rich country. But we don't manage this very well, maybe the last many years. But today we'll try to manage this much better than before. Lowlands, a high impact landscape of for climate change. This, if you look at this data, this slide, Indonesia lowlands cover approximately 34 million hectares, composed of peatland. Maybe you are not aware, the peatland globally, Indonesia is around 41%, and mangrove like 32%. So we give a lot of contribution in terms of carbon. People sometimes complain about the palm oil, but they forgot that we also contribute carbon from peatland, mangrove, forestry, because Indonesia have this, all those things. Now, benefit of mangrove ecosystem, mangrove could protect coastal rain environment by reducing impact ocean waves or tsunami. We experienced this one in Palu some time ago. With the tsunami like 7 meter, the mangrove could reduce the impact of this tsunami. So now we work very hard to replanting program for the mangrove. Peatlands as a climate change and climate change function. If you look at the slide, ladies and gentlemen, peatland function of peatland. Peatland are the most efficient terrestrial ecosystem in storing carbon. So we own like 51 or 41% of the peatland worldwide. But the peatland in Indonesia produce much more carbon than peatland in Scandinavia, in Norway, for instance. So this is different. So if you include peatland that we have, and mangrove, and forestry, and seagrass, maybe you can contribute like 70 to 80% of carbon. So we work for this right now, if you look at this one. So now we are study very much. I just had lunch with special envoy from Norway about the climate change, and been discussed how do we mitigate this one, how do we help the farmer in the area instead of convert this peatland to the any crops. How do we help them to do something over there, but they get something also for their life? Indonesia achievement on the peatland restoration in 2020, if you look at this slide, I think we are already moving very well. We not only criticize this and that, but if you look at this size of the one example of the peatland, and only one example, you can see a lot like this in Indonesia. Not only the fire, the haze that you maybe understand when you look at to the media. Peatland restoration activities in Riau province, for example, like this, we are working very hard for this. We don't want to see any more like the cone of the peatland took it out by the big company to be or to grow something over there. We have to maintain the cone of the peatland in that area. Ladies and gentlemen, maybe you don't aware about the depth of the peatland. In some area, they can go 50 meters. I say 50 meters. when they have problem over there, burn during the very dry season, it's very hard to extinguish this one. We have to wait the heavy rain 3 days, then we can able to extinguish this fire. Woodland and forest fires, if you look at this one, the size, Amazon is 930,000 hectares, Indonesia 328,000, Siberia 13 million, but very rare people over there, Canary Island 10,000 hectares. This example that contribution to the very bad emission around the globe. So Indonesia again, we like to fix this one. We admitted that we are also have problem over there, but it's not easy to deal with this issue, especially during the very dry season like this year. Indonesia effort in handling and mitigating forest fire, like you see this, we are working very hard round the clock. Indonesian Air Force with the Hercules, CASA, we just deploy all the asset that we have to, you know, taking care of this fire, but not easy because I was in charge of the very big fire back to 2015. So I experienced this very much and how difficult to deal with, especially with the peatland. When you deal with the peatland, because my own experience, I didn't know before that some of the peatland can go down to 50 meters, 10 meters. When below, I mean, like 5 meters or maybe 10 meters, forget it. You're not going to extinguish the fire by just bombarding with the airplane. You have to do how do we can create that heavy rain could come 3 days in a row in order to extinguish this fire. So if people sometimes criticize Indonesia, I said, hey, have you seen this problem? If you don't comment. I went there, I spent many times over there, I can feel very hard to breathe, you know, because of the haze. So our issue, ladies and gentlemen, we care that other country complain about this, but the first thing that we care, our own people, victim of this. So don't feel that we allow this thing happen, no. We are thinking for the interests of the people of Indonesia. Ladies and gentlemen, this next slide. If you look at now impact of plastic litter, tourism litter, the ocean cover a lot of tourism object and on the coast. We work very hard on this. If you look at the slide, this is like one area surfing that we experience. But this is not only from Indonesia. The breeze who are in Indonesia. Many countries also contribute to this one because Indonesia, largest archipelagic country. Marine environment and life, human health, we understand this one. So we are working very hard to tackle this issue. Next. Leakage plastic for land and ocean environment in Indonesia. And if you look at also the we understand the size, that how do we deal with this issue? And we work very hard, and the government of Indonesia also commit to launch any many program in order to tackle this issue. Commitment of the government of Indonesia combating marine plastic debris, I think you can see this slide, reduce, reuse, and recycle. Until 2025, our plan to reduce the waste is around 30%. Next slide. Now, launching of Indonesian Clean Movement, been doing this one, not only talking. If you go to Indonesia today, you can see that many, many activities right now, how to handle so many plastic here and there. We already announced now by city to city, no more single use of plastic bag. And we have already present issue already decree on waste to energy. Next slide. This is clean action by community in tourist tourism destination. We are working around the clock to tackle this one because this is a global problem, not only Indonesian problem. So let's work together in order to tackle this issue. If you look at also the next slide, this is the one example. Citarum River, one of the dirtiest river in the world. This is announced by Washington Post like a year and a half ago. So we work around the clock to tackle this one. If you look at now the slide before and after, this is, I think, the successful of that, you know. I still remember the first time I went to this place, you can walk on the garbage, you know, on the dirty things on the top, even on the bottom. But today, the situation like this. But not only this, I think the beauty of this, the people surrounding the river, they understand. If they throw the garbage to the river, this can be melt to be microplastic. Microplastic can eaten by the fish, and fish eaten by the human. It could affect the health of the people. So the woman, for instance, if you can still deliver the baby, your delivery could be stunting. So they understand now. We socialize this very clear. We don't want to see the next generation of Indonesia stunting generation. So that's, I think, make the spirit today in order to encourage them to work together with their government. Hey, this is our problem. It's nothing to do with the religion, nothing to do with the political party, nothing to do with the tribes. This is pure for the next generation of Indonesia. If you look at also the next slide, this is what can we do. This is, I think, the slogan, kurangi kantong plastik, meaning reuse or only or single use of plastic. Reduce, recycle. We insert to the curriculum right now from the kindergarten, elementary, junior, and high school, university about this one. We have to socialize the importance of this. So people sometimes ask me, you know, about, hey, you have to be careful or you have to take care because of palm oil, the emission, this and that. I said, hey, look, we are also has responsibility for our next generation, the Indonesian next generation. We are not gonna set up policy that could jeopardize the health of the next generation of Indonesia. Let me repeat again, we are not gonna set up the policy of the government in Indonesia could jeopardize the health of the people of Indonesia years to come. So, ladies and gentlemen, we are very aware about this problem, and we work very hard. But again, I don't think that we can do it alone. Next slide. Innovation, technology, intervention, we are doing this one now. We work very hard. Plastic tar road, we're implementing this one already. We increase time to time. Because we can add 10% to the asphalt tar, then can you see we can reduce the cost and also the rehabilitation of this asphalt or road, like 30-40%. So we like to see India as a good example, because in India they experience already in this, I think, if I'm not mistaken, 120,000 kilometers. Waste to energy, recently President already issued a decree. And we have like 17 cities, not 12 cities. This is, I think, still 12 cities, but already in the pilot project, 17 cities. We move parallelly in order to, you know, manage the waste in so much in so many cities. Next slide. Waste to energy plan are processing now in progress in Solo, Surabaya, you name it. This is a city right now. We are moving very much. We make it massive in order to tackle this problem. Next slide. My conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, in terms of economy, our economy is quite good, although the trade war, but again, government Indonesia very carefully manage our own fiscal and our monetary. So we have to be careful much, but with the efficiency, with the management, with the leadership of President Joko Widodo, we are quite confident also that we can manage Indonesia very well. And World Bank also gave very good advice to us time to time, and we thank you to the World Bank in Indonesia, because they give also critique, they give also support, they give also very open advice to the government of Indonesia. Indonesian ocean economic prospect will be prosperous to support social and political stability in Indonesia. We are very rich on the fish, so we like to see more and more investment on fish, but we manage also, we don't want overfishing also in Indonesia. Indonesia achievement on nationally determined contribution through strengthening mitigation and adaptation of the climate change impact. We work very hard on this right now. This number four, I think very important, is committed to working with domestic international partner to create strategic momentum for a peatland financing initiative, which is a thing we look for this one. And that's why I had lunch with the special envoy from Norway. He was ambassador to Jakarta, and we discussed this one, and they are willing to put, you know, some fund to support this program. Indonesia has taken bold action to address the problem of marine plastic debris, highlighting the innovative technological solution. So we are working very hard to see in terms of technology to solve this problem. So ladies and gentlemen, don't hesitate, you know, about Indonesia. Some people thought that Indonesia is a small country. We don't care about the environment. We care about the environment. I was in European Union Parliament sometimes ago. They don't even understand the size of Indonesia. They thought that Indonesia like only Bali, you know. I said, no, Bali is the only small part of Indonesia. We have three time zone. Our population, 270 million. The middle class is like 55 million people. So a big market. Our GDP, $1.1 trillion. But GDP, they count because of, based on export on raw material, which is no more. We like to see added value. I explained to you earlier that used to be we export nickel ore from Indonesia like $350 million to $400 million a year. But since three and a half years ago, we worked very hard to see the added value. Last year, we export from Indonesia added value of the nickel ore like $5.8 billion. This year is going to be $7.2 billion. The year after, we can export around $12 billion, and by 2024, we can export like $30 billion because of the nickel, from nickel ore, stainless steel, carbon steel, to the lithium battery. So that's all about Indonesia. This is only one resource. We are not talking yet about tin. We are not talking yet about bauxite. We are not talking yet about asphalt. We are talking about many things. We produce one of the largest rubber production on Earth. So if we manage this very well, then we can see that our GDP growth not going to be 5%. Maybe can go to 8-9%. So I believe our GDP can go up by 2035 or 2040. It's around maybe $15 trillion instead of the $11 trillion. So ladies and gentlemen, this is Indonesia. Indonesia reform now our regulation, our law, in order to give also opportunity for the foreign investor to invest in Indonesia. I'm more than happy to take any question from all of you. And again, thank you very much, and come over to Indonesia. Don't hesitate in terms of stability in Indonesia, in terms of security, in terms of political stability in Indonesia, it's okay. Democracy, demonstration sometimes here and up, yeah, but we don't experience yet that impeachment process. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Minister.
Yes. Where do we go?
Excellency.
Okay, thank you. Where do I sit? Okay, thank you.
So I do need a little bit of help in terms of if you can put your questions on the hashtag ICSD2019. If you have any questions, I'll pull them up. I've been watching the Twitter, and I have a few questions, so I hope it's okay.
Yes.
Good. Put my glasses on so I can. So there's a few questions. So one is fish bombing still a big problem? Can you give an idea what steps you are taking to protect the coral reefs and small fishermen?
Well, this is one issue, yes. It used to be a lot of, fishermen just use, bomb, to get the fish. I think less and less right now. We work very hard for this. And, so again, to educate the people in the third world country is not easy. But I promise you today, much better than before. Yeah.
Okay. Another question. UN estimates that by 2050, there could be more plastic in the ocean than fish. Indonesia is one of the countries which is responsible for this. What actions is the government taking to address this challenge? I think you were talking about that a bit, the plastic.
Yeah, we are working very hard on this issue, you know. But again, don't blame Indonesia. This plastic, they don't have their own country. They don't have their own border, you know. They just traveling because of the wave, you know, because of the current. So that's one issue. But the other issue, of course, we have to discipline our people, you know, because 80% of the plastic on ocean is come from the land. Yeah, so we have to educate our people to tell them, hey, don't throw plastic to the ocean or to the river, because this can melt to be macroplastic eaten by the by the fish, and on, so they understand now. But it takes time, of course, to clean up the whole ocean, because Indonesia, the size of Indonesia, 30% land. The rest is ocean. Yeah.
So another question is about the islands. So are some islands of Indonesia susceptible to sea level rise? And what types steps are you taking to mitigate the problem? Have you been involved in the Samoa Pathway sort of discussions? Have you been involved in the Samoa Pathway dialogues? Or is Indonesia considered island in that sense? Or?
Well, yeah, we understand the sea rising. You're talking about that, yes. Yeah. This is also one issue that we are, watch very much, because this could also, problem with some area, Even in Jakarta also right now, we are facing this problem. So that's the one reason maybe. That's one reason also for us to relocate or to move our capital to other island.
Oh, I see. But do you think mitigation cannot be by Indonesia alone, that it's kind of a multilateral?
I don't think that we can do it, because like I mentioned to you earlier, like replanting mangrove, one action that they're taking right now. But since the size of mangrove already, destroyed, that we need more support from the international communities.
There's a question here, and you did give an example at the end, actually, was how government works effectively with different kind of sectors, like the private sector and civil society on the SDGs. You did give one good example, but is there kind of frameworks in Indonesia that are pushing this?
We are working very hard right now with so many institutions, international institutions, for the mitigation. I said, how do we grow the mangrove, how do you take care of the peatland, how do you do the forestry, how do you do with the coral reef? I don't think that we can do it alone, but we invite many countries to be part of, to be our partner to tackle this issue. And so far, I think the progress moving quite good.
So I'm from Ireland, obviously, so I'm particularly interested in the peatland, because we have that sort of issue. But what sort of, I think you talked about it a bit, but the strategies of, like, why are people using the peatland in the first place, and what are you trying to do in terms of actually bringing it back as a carbon sort of capture area, or so what sort of incentives and policies can you do there?
Yeah, this gentleman, Razi, so one of the players right now on the carbon, credit on this, I think we give the conservation to this company like him, and we give also to other, but they have obligation to take care of this peatland, Right. They can sell the carbon credit to any countries in Europe, for instance, because if you look at the carbon credit that produced by by our peatland, by, you know, mangrove, that's huge. Indonesia may be the superpower on the carbon credit potential.
So my understanding of that is that people outside of Indonesia can pay money to actually keep the land out of use. Is that the idea of the carbon credit? Or?
Well, no. They deal with the foreign countries, basically, yeah. With foreign company, how to, you know, taking care of this. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Indonesia is a gateway between two oceans that are undergoing big change. Would you be willing to support the creation of a big institute or a gateway climate change institute? So this is the idea of setting up some research institute.
Oh, we don't mind at all to establish cooperation with any institution in order to take care of the ocean, you know, because this is not only this ocean belongs to Indonesia, you know. Everybody has responsibility also for the next generation of humankind. So I give you one example, you know, with IMO right now we are working, you know, how do we take care of the so many ships right now that crossed our Alki, you know, from Sunda Strait and from Lombok Strait, you know, in terms of environment. And then we come up with the idea they have to pay something in order to maintain clean area in that particular strait. Yeah.
So there's a question at the end. You were talking about the prospects for economic growth.
Yes.
And obviously a lot of the talk was about sustainability issues. Mm-hmm. But is there ever a scenario that you can think of where you would trade that off, where you would be prepared, like for the health and the sustainability of the country, to actually have lower economic growth? Or do you see that as a risk to your financial position?
Well, like I mentioned earlier, before we never touch the value added for our economy. Yeah. No. Yeah. We just rely on the, you know, export raw material.
Right, you're export oriented.
Yeah. But right now, we look at that we can do also on that variant. So I mentioned about the nickel ore. We can do also tin. We can do also added value for bauxite, you know. So Indonesia can be a global player within 5 years' time on this area. Now, on the peatland, on the carbon credit, you know, when you're talking the near future, this become a hot issue. So people blame Indonesia because of palm oil, for instance. You know. It's not true, you know. We contribute a lot. Maybe 70% of the carbon right now is from Indonesia.
There's a question here about what steps to take, and I think you did talk about it, but maybe a little bit more on this concept of sustainable tourism. It's a beautiful country. And
yeah, this is, I think, the problem of the tourist destination Indonesia. They have one tourist destination, for instance, like, let's say, like Lake Toba. But we never fix the, you know, the spot in that area, like the cultural performance, train of the people, accommodation, and many things. Right now, the government pay attention on this and invest in this area. And also, we invite the private sector to do this.
Okay.
So, very fast, you see the changing right now in Indonesia.
So that's interesting, private partnership, yeah. So just to reiterate, or just to summarize, the sort of key priorities for action, for SDG action. So where would you see the top four things that can be done?
And to
rank them.
Well, yeah, I said today, number one, yeah, human capital. You know,
human capital.
Okay. We have to educate our people, you know.
Okay.
Well, we are doing this and that. If we don't educate our people, if we don't socialize this program, it's not going to work, you know. So I think human capital is very important in Indonesia today, and which is, I'm seeing also the first top priority of the president, Jokowi, in his second term.
And within that, we had that this morning where people talk about the role of education in the SDGs, but within building the human capital of the country, and it's an issue for all countries, do you see a kind of a revision of the education curriculum?
Yeah, in Indonesia?
In Indonesia, and even asking when you're funding your universities maybe that they would orientate their science a little bit and their research towards the sort of major challenges that you've outlined here.
Yes.
So do you think that could be
Yes,
there's been a few calls for that already today.
This is, I think, the president very aware of that.
Yeah.
So we like to more focus on, you know, like information technology, you know, artificial intelligence, talking about mathematics, like physics, you know, like entrepreneurship.
Yeah.
It's very important. You know, so far we maybe too much curriculum on the political science. Sorry, I don't want to.
Social science.
Science, you know, but we need also about technology, you know, because to see added value, we need a kind of technology. Yeah.
Okay, excellent. So I've come to the end of my questions, but I think a big round of applause for the Excellency and General. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Before we end this, my presentation, ladies and gentlemen. Again, I would like to give a better understanding about Indonesia, like, because my experience the last 5 years being a minister, and a lot of people doesn't understand about Indonesia. They don't know Indonesia quite well. So many foreign countries thought that Indonesia is only small country, weak country, poor country, which is not true. Indonesia has a very strong wish and will to make Indonesia better. Yeah, I hear the slogan, make America greater again, a great America again, whatever a slogan, but Indonesia also has a program to make Indonesia much, much better in their future. So if people criticize Indonesia about human rights, about environment, about this, it's not true. But we are ongoing right now. We are moving toward that direction. Human rights in Indonesia very open, very. I was a coordinating minister for security affairs, you know. On human rights, we opened very much. Everybody can criticize, but as long as you bring data, don't only talking, you know, bring the data, criticize, we are very open to discuss. We are talking about the environment as well, you know. People also think, well, Indonesia, palm oil jeopardized the environment. I say, why? You're talking compared to soya bean, compared to other things, palm oil is much better. This is, I think, study done by the Stanford. We asked the Stanford University to do research on this. So, yeah, but people still look at Indonesia, many foreign people, look at, hey, Indonesia is unstable. What do you mean unstable, you know? We still manage Indonesia very well. We don't have much issue like, you know, all of a sudden, you know, kill so many people in one area in the university or in the high school. No, it never happened in Indonesia. But we are a problem. We are facing problem about the radicalism. Yes, we are working very hard to tackle this one by changing or improve our curriculum in our society. So Indonesia is very open. Indonesia is a very rich country. We are not banana republic. Yeah. I'm serious, we are not banana republic. Indonesia is a great country. We work with heart. I promise you, you see the different Indonesia after 5 years. In the next 5 years, you're gonna see much different Indonesia, make Indonesia better and better. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, On that note, I am very pleased to let you know that the Coordinating Ministry for Maritime Affairs, Republic of Indonesia, is signing a MOU with the Earth Institute, Columbia University, on capacity building and innovation. So this is our honor to be signing a MOU with the ministry. And just as a small gesture of appreciation, we'll give some token that's actually made by our girls who are in Ghana and have made these eco-friendly bags.
Thank you, Prof.
Thank you so much. What a wonderful job.
Thank you. Thank you.